Hello and welcome to my channel Spark Stenographer. Today I am going to deliver you a shortened dictation from Kailash Chandra magazine volume number 13 and the transcription number 282. So guys, ready for the dictation? 10 seconds, 5 seconds. Start. I do not propose, sir, in the beginning to make a very long speech for the simple reason that I am more anxious to hear and to profit by the observations of my honorable friends who will follow me. A number of amendments have been tabled and I imagine that many of those amendments will be moved and very many constructive and helpful suggestions will be made. The House is aware that under the Constitution there is a special officer appointed by the President. I should like at the very beginning to pay a tribute to his hard work and the devotion with which he has worked will be shown by the very exhaustive report that he has submitted to this House. In all our discussions, you will please recollect that leaving aside the Part C states, the administration of all affairs, including affairs relating to Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribes, rest in the first instance with the state governments. So far as part of states are concerned, their autonomy is fairly large, or rather in this particular matter we can only give them advice, offer them suggestions or give them money. So far as the Part B states are concerned, it is true that under the Constitution, directives may be sent, but they are also carrying on their affairs with fully elected legislative bodies. And I just remind the House that the power of giving directives is not an unlimited power in terms of an unlimited power in terms of period of time. It is only for 10 years. 4 years are expiring and another 6 years will remain. Therefore, while we discuss the affairs of Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribes, we should remember as far as possible that the actual administration lies in what I may call the provisional sphere. Of course, so far as the Government of India or the central government departments are concerned, many questions may be raised. I see whenever the Parliament is in session that members are very keen to know whether advantage has been given to the Scheduled Caste and the Scheduled Tribes in regard to their reserved seats. Honorable members would have seen in the report as to what actually has been done. I should like at the outset to assure every single member of the House that the central government spares no pains to see to it that the Scheduled Caste and the Scheduled Tribes have the fullest opportunity of rendering public service. I would beg honorable members to remember that when we appoint a district magistrate, for instance, he is not merely a district magistrate or for looking after the Scheduled Caste living in that district, whether they are 1 lakh or 2 lakhs or 20 lakhs, but he is the district magistrate for the entire district. He is the district magistrate for the high caste and the low caste and the Muslims and Sikhs, everybody. Therefore, the Public Service Commission for the appointing authority is bound to have some regard for efficiency. But there are certain appointments in which we cannot take any risk. Our anxiety is there, and our anxiety is shared by the Union Public Service Commission that all opportunities should be afforded to the scheduled caste and the scheduled tribes. I do not want to repeat what I said on the last occasion that we have relaxed the rules as to age limits. I am sure that the Union Public Service Commission, when these candidates come for Viva Voce examination for interviews, makes due allowance for the fact that there is bound to be a great deal of difference as between boys or candidates who are coming from, let us say, well-regulated families, wealthy families, and young men who are coming from rather lower income groups. I know that the Commission makes allowance for this fact, but when all is said and done, you cannot take very many risks in this matter. What is much more important is that there should be every effort made for their educational uplift, and concessions should be given. Scholarships should be given. I am all in favor of these young boys from the scheduled caste and backward classes to be sent to England and foreign countries for education. Then there is another matter. I know that in urban areas, untouchability has practically disappeared, and complaints are rife that this is not so in rural areas. I know that, but you have got to take your countrymen as they are. I promised last year that we will take every possible legislative step to remove untouchability and punish untouchability. And I may inform honorable members that before Parliament rises, I may either introduce a bill against untouchability and for punishment of offenses arising out of the practice of untouchability, or publish it in the Gazetted, and then we will discuss it in coming budget session. But the point that I am arising is that the conserve process can go only to some extent. We must not forget the importance of the persuasive process. You cannot ride the high horse only by adopting conserve measures. Stop.